Good afternoon and welcome back to India and China at Sea. So the first session this afternoon, we're going to have Pramit Pal Chowdhury, as I mentioned, would-be foreign minister, foreign editor, Hindustan Times. And as I think everyone already knows, an excellent and articulate speaker on Indian foreign policy. And he's going to be, I think, fairly directly addressing Lee Cordner's question earlier about, why this conference has been looking at the India-China relationship primarily through the lens of competition rather than cooperation. And I think Pramit will give some excellent context to or explanation for that. And in response to Pramit's presentation, we have Professor J.D. Yuan from University of Sydney, who is among his many qualifications is an excellent book on India-China security relations, which that came out about a decade or so ago, but I think it remains in many respects just as valid as the day it was written.
So what I'll do is I'll basically speak about how I see the evolution of India's Indian Ocean strategy and policy since the previous government under Manmohan Singh, the UPA government, which ran from 2004 to 2014, and how it's evolved, if you wish, since then, and the key differences between the two. And at the heart of it is what has been, as what Dave has mentioned, was the debate about how to tackle China or how to try to relate to China, and basically then give some thoughts about where we might be going in the future on this. The Manmohan Singh government was, especially in its second term, highly dysfunctional. It was a government that had more or less internally collapsed because of various scandals and because of a battle between the party leader, Sonia Gandhi, and the prime minister. And in the second term, where we saw, the first term was really largely about the Indo-US nuclear deal. I mean, it really consumed all the oxygen in the air. And was transformational in terms of what it did between India and the United States. The second term, we saw Manmohan Singh, as I said, at this point, his government began falling apart. And he had a foreign policy team, which to many ways, I would argue, did not reflect his own point of view. He had a national security advisor who was the person who really led the foreign policy, Shiv Shankar Menon, a Mandarin-speaking former foreign secretary. And he had a defense minister, A.K. Antony, who was definitely not his choice, who was appointed by Sonia Gandhi, and who was a left-leaning, very anti-American defense minister, was appointed in place. Antony, the defense minister, was basically driven by a very clear policy, which was don't get too close to the Americans because you lose votes on the left in India. Which would be crucial for the election that Congress government saw coming in 2014. But he was also driven by another bigger game, which was that Sonia Gandhi didn't want a scandal in defense, because a defense acquisition scandal, the so-called Bofors gun scandal, had destroyed her husband's, Rajiv Gandhi's government earlier, and she didn't want a repeat performance on that front. Antony, who was honest, but didn't actually know anything or understand defense at all, solution to this was not to buy anything or do anything. And for basically 5 years, India had no defense policy whatsoever. We bought no weapons for 5 years. And so his was a very clear policy, don't do anything. And so the result was our defense policy, in effect, froze. And it stayed in stasis for almost that entire period. Menon came in. And theoretically inherited the huge spike in Indo-US relations that had taken place during the Bush administration. India was one of the few countries in the world where Bush had a record approval rating, over 75%. And it was when Obama was elected, actually, U.S. approval ratings in India fell by 15 percentage points. This was not a country that particularly cared or was unhappy that Obama was elected, and was not unhappy when Bush left. It was very much a relationship driven by Bush, because of various reasons we can go into. But at the heart of it was an understanding between Bush and Singh that what Bush called the balance of power for freedom in Asia had to be preserved, and that the rise of China, while it was not necessarily an existential threat to this, but the nature of maintaining democracy in Asia for Bush and for Singh was that the U.S.-India relationship had to be transformed. And they did this. Menon inherited this policy, but he inherited an Obama presidency. And Obama, in effect, by the so-called G2 policy, if it was not an official policy, but an attempt to reach out to China and develop an accommodation with China regarding larger global issues and Asia in general, was seen by the Indian side as an effective an end or an undermining of that original understanding that they had with the Bush administration. They also found Obama to be much more transactional than Bush was, who was actually much more strategic in his thinking than Obama was. Obama's basic was that, okay, if we're going to give you, even if my predecessor was the one who gave you this deal, then you got to buy X number of things from me. Anyway, the relationship began to fall apart after Obama was elected. By 2009, Menon had concluded, in 2010, Menon concluded that, in fact, the Indo-US relationship had been a Bush-India relationship, and there was really no basis for thinking that there was being a fundamental change in the India-US relationship. Menon basically didn't trust the United States to be a stable, stable strategic partner. And there were other issues that they had with the United States, particularly Obama's decision that he wanted to pull out of Afghanistan at all costs, which meant that India and the U.S. effectively were at loggerheads in Afghanistan. But as Menon was very clear in his private conversations, I don't actually see what is the strategic basis of this relationship. If we're not agreeing on China and we're not agreeing on Pakistan, then what's left? That didn't mean he necessarily trusted China either. He was very clear that China was not a country that he particularly, or anybody in India, could trust at the senior level. But he has believed that since America was not to be trusted, therefore some sort of accommodation had to be reached between India and China. I'll give him a quote that he gave in 2013. He said, quote, and it's in the paper that was distributed to everybody on India's ocean policy, but it said, the inconstancy in stated policy and U.S. actions towards the Asia-Pacific over the last 2 years does not inspire confidence. We must not be drawn into choosing sides. And this is obvious reference to China. He also made the argument that ultimately, in the long run, it was going to be China that mattered in Asia, not the United States. Because, quote, the balance of interests is also in China's favor. She will be ready to pay a price to get her way, which the United States and other extra-regional powers would not. And so fundamentally, he saw that over the long run, it would be America leaving Asia, and everything that Obama did, in his view, fed into the sense of an America that was effectively in retreat. And the Indian Ocean part of this was his rejection, complete rejection, of the idea both that the Indo-Pacific as a strategic concept, because in his view, that was effectively a code word for Chinese containment, and an attempt to bring in countries like Japan and link India to America's Western Pacific strategy. And he very publicly refuted this. There's no such thing as the Indo-Pacific. And he publicly refuted the idea that there was anything like maritime rivalry between China and India of any variety. So this is essentially a concoction of think tanks and academics. He also argued that China's maritime expansion into the Indian Ocean, the submarines and so on that began to appear, was, he said, that's just a normal state of affairs. He called it the new norm, that if Indian ships going into the Pacific, Chinese ships going to Indian Ocean, so this is not a matter of concern. It's just a natural progress of two countries, two rising countries. He said the solution, therefore, to all of this was just a need to develop a regional, preferably a regional architecture that allowed all sides to sit at the same chart. But it also meant a degree of, as I said, reaching out to China and he attempted very hard to create some sort of a dialogue and come to a similar, if you wish, his own little G2 policy between China and India. What was the key problem that he faced, though? The key problem was that the policy completely failed because China was not interested. And between 2013 and 2014, there was an attempt on almost all fronts under Menon and passively under Antony to try to come to some sort of an accommodation with China. And China rejected it all throughout during that entire period. We saw absolutely no forward movement. In fact, I would go further. From 2012 onwards, India tried repeatedly to try this. Menon saw the Indian Ocean and the maritime area as being the area where he could most likely succeed in coming to some accommodation with China. He accepted that the border dispute was simply too difficult to solve. It was a management issue, but it was relatively quiet. He didn't have any problems with it, but he didn't expect to be able to solve that. That required a degree of political capital, which definitely his government did not have. He knew that there was never going to be any agreement between China and India on Pakistan. And there were a lot of other smaller areas where he saw that would be either too difficult. But he actually saw the maritime area as the area of greatest convergence, whether it was SLOCs and so on. He said this is the place we can come to some sort of an understanding with China. And he tried repeatedly. So he offered China a maritime dialogue between the two countries, and China would basically said, we're not interested in talking to you. So for almost 2 to 3 years, the Indian government under him tried to come to some sort of understanding on the maritime issues, hold some sort of a dialogue, some agreement. Nothing happened. Beijing was simply, especially in the last 2 years of the Hu Jintao regime, Beijing was simply uninterested. Then Xi Jinping comes to power, and we could see Menon trying at this point again. Okay, this at least we have now have a Chinese leader who potentially is stronger, than Hu, is not so obsessed with the succession struggles. It didn't make any difference. She was as disinterested as he was, and Xi's first state visit, I think as David mentioned, to India was marred by a major border clash between India and China. And whatever little was left of Menon's credibility within his own government was effectively dead after that incident happened. Menon himself bitterly complained to us in private that China had shown itself to be as he called an, quote, autistic superpower. Because he simply could not understand why it was so difficult for China to understand what he thought was a clear area of mutual interest between the two. And I would argue that the final blow to this school of thinking in India was the announcement of One Belt, One Road. Because fundamentally what it was is that you had until now a border dispute and you had a maritime policy which were not linked with each other. And in the view of the Indian strategic community, especially at the highest level, China had in effect brought these two together. That the One Belt, One Road, thanks to the China-Pakistan economic corridor and what was planned in Southeast Asia, effectively brought the entire border infrastructure of the North and linked it with a maritime policy, a connectivity policy. At this point, these two policies basically began to be seen as merging into one, as far as India was concerned. And Menon's continuing inability, and I should add another thing that we began to do, is began to ask China for a dialogue on the One Belt, One Road. Explain to us, was the Indian argument, what exactly are you planning here? How much is economic? How much is strategic? We're not necessarily opposed to this idea, but you need to give us some transparency. Again, total silence from Beijing. There's still to this date not been any attempt or interest on by part of China to explain to India what exactly the One Belt, One Road, at least in the closed door government-to-government level. So when that government fell in 2014 and Narendra Modi came to power, it was very unclear as to what Narendra Modi's actual views on China were. privately, when you talk to them, remember he was a man who'd lived, he'd been a state government chief minister all his political life. He'd never served in Delhi as a minister or in any position in the central government. He really saw foreign policy largely through an economic prism. It was basically about trade and investment. And as a chief minister, he'd had a perfectly good relationship with Chinese business. And he saw that to some degree, his view was I can just expand this onto the central government level. And his view was that Xi Jinping, interested, as has been previously mentioned, about trying to increase Chinese investment into India, would therefore be more or less agreeable to what he had in mind. He was also, I should add, suspicious of the United States. Partly because the United States had issued a visa ban on Modi after anti-Muslim riots and when he was chief minister in Gujarat in 2002. He had virtually no interaction with the United States for almost 10 years. He saw the Obama administration, which had continued to criticize him in some form or another on human rights issues, as being inimically hostile. And therefore, his campaign advisors, I remember, told me soon after he was elected, he says, we don't really expect there ever to be an Obama-Modi summit. This is not going to happen. This will be, as he said, and they told me, a New York-New Delhi relationship, i.e. it'll be trade and investment, but there'll be nothing else, and we may have to wait until the next U.S. president to get this relationship going. So what happens to that vision, that broad instinct that he came to power with? Within just about a year, and I would again say that this is an example of how China sometimes, well, maybe they're not interested, but it's an interesting example of how China can get it wrong, that policy had been completely reversed. As I said, Xi made a state visit. It resulted in a major border incident, which was a great embarrassment to Modi. They struggled to find areas of convergence. And while there was a sense at 2014 within the Indian side that we have some sort of an understanding with Xi about changing the relationship and making it more focused on less on the disputes and more on the economics and the trade, China was found to be hard going to get the Chinese to talk almost anything. Continuing differences, unwillingness to talk about One Belt, One Road, on maritime, on almost anything that mattered to China. And on top of that, in the same month that he met Xi, he then went to eventually did meet Obama in Washington. I remember I met him just after the announcement for the Obama summit, and I said, I thought you were never going to meet Obama. So Modi looked a little embarrassed, and he says, well, I was never going to ask for a summit, but as it is, Obama rang me up and said, why didn't you come and meet me? And a little difficult to tell the President of the United States to his face, no, I'm not going to come and see you. But as it is, the summit went very well. And Obama made it very clear that America had not only made a mistake on the visa, but more importantly, that all of everything that Modi's domestic agenda was about, which included renewable energy, should make it very clear, one thing they really bonded on is climate change. In India, it is the right wing which is the party of climate change. The BJP is the party that supports renewable energy and believes that climate change is a major problem for the country. It is the left that argues it's a Western problem, let them solve it. So in effect, by October, November, Modi was looking at it and saying, actually, my original assumptions on foreign policy were wrong. The US and China game is actually quite different. And through December, he actually began to call in people like Menon and others in the Indian, all our China experts, one by one, and sometimes in clusters, and asked them basically, what do you think I need to do about China? And the two broad schools, one was the Menon school, which was basically the U.S. cannot be trusted. It is simply now a country that it no longer has the stability, strategic stability to maintain, to become dependable in Asia. So we need to work out something with China, no matter how much we have difficulties with them. And another school, which basically said, no, actually, if you look at the record, when we have been close to the United States, as for example during the Bush administration, we have found that the Chinese are a lot more agreeable on almost everything. So the game should be, even if you don't want to ally with America, play the US card. There are a lot of things we can get from the United States in the meantime. So even if you play it for only 10 or 20 years, it's still worth it. But Chinese take it a lot more seriously, and we'll find them much more agreeable. Eventually, I think by January, and then when Modi and Obama met again in January 2015, Obama came as the first American chief guest for Republic Day. They issued a joint, for the first time, the two countries issued a joint strategic vision on the Asia-Pacific and Indian Ocean region. Now, in many ways, there was nothing all that exciting about the document. When you went through it, you realized it actually just incorporated language that America and India had agreed on earlier in various other forums and meetings. But the point was that it was all put together, and it was put together at Modi's request. There's a New York Times article describing how Modi met and told Obama, "I'm having problems with China." And Obama said, "I don't disagree, so am I. And how do you want to address it?" And Modi said, "Why don't we issue a joint statement together?" And the American reaction was, "We've been trying to get you for 20 years to do this. And now you're ready. We're more than happy. We'll do it right now." And they basically sat down that afternoon and began to draft to put that together. So you start to see, and if you look at that document, it puts in that we support UNCLOS, we support the rule of law, so on and so forth. That specific, it doesn't mention China specifically anywhere, but it's very clear who this document is aimed at. And so you now start to see the Indian Ocean strategy of India at this point, which at that point, as I said, was still very unclear, begins to come in focus. Because India, once you got the big picture here, you got the US and China relationship going in that context, then the Indian Ocean immediately fits into place. And you get an idea where the Indian Ocean was not just about the US-China game, of course, there are other aspects to it. And I think where Indian Ocean begins to fit in with Modi is that it combines the following. One, it fits in with his larger geopolitical vision of the relationship between US and China. It fits in with his neighborhood policy. Modi has been very clear, and both in public and private, that he is particularly distressed at the fact that India's smaller neighbors, i.e. Pakistan and China, are on a different league, but Bangladesh, Nepal, countries that he sees as culturally close to India, don't like India. And he has been, since day one, he has been very, very bothered by this, and has sought very hard to put those relations in particular onto a certain new long-term rapprochement with India. Now, it happens to fit in that part of the number of these countries, notably Sri Lanka, Maldives, and if you want to extend it a bit, Mauritius and Bangladesh are very much part of the Indian Ocean game, that any Indian Ocean policy that India would play. Second, his interest in the Indian diaspora, which has been a big part of his party's campaign overseas. It's seen as part of, fits in with a larger, should we say, Hindu nationalist ideology that sees areas and the children of India, quote-unquote, of Indic civilization as something that have to be encouraged to be part and closer of India. And of course, there's a large Indian diaspora in Eastern Africa and almost all the island states of the Indian Ocean and to some degree in Southeast Asia. And I should throw in Australia now as well. And then, of course, you have the issue of needing to counter both Chinese naval influence and fill in a vacuum that is being created by the slow withdrawal of U.S., if not U.S. power, but of U.S. interest in using that power in the Indian Ocean area. And on the flip side was that, this is not Modi's as much as the foreign ministry and the intelligence services, was looking at China, their view came in, and then again, as once Modi opens up the barrier to the non-Menon school of thinking, these all then start to fit in into a larger into this larger picture, which was that basically when we looked at China, their argument was simple. The decision of the National People's Congress calling for China to become a full-fledged maritime power meant that in their view, China was very clearly signaling its interest to expand its power at some point or another slowly into the Indian Ocean. And as has been mentioned, the One Belt, One Road program was seen as again another game changer for the Indian side, that not only would it tightly bring the Indo-Sino-Pakistan relationship much closer together, it would effectively, as I said, bring the border and the boundary dispute that they had with India would be effectively now connected to a much larger regional and continental grid. And why is the China-Pakistan relationship important? This because in India's view, and very clear, and when I look at the notes that I've seen in previous briefings in the past year, they see that meaning that China will now give, they've always given a bit, but they're now given even more cover to Pakistan in Pakistan's, should we say, use of terrorism and other, other black ops against India. And that China would effectively block India's rise on various global platforms, if they saw this as a zero-sum game regarding India and Pakistan. And a perfect example of that recently was India's bid to join the nuclear suppliers group, where China, in effect, in its private conversation, said, "Yeah, actually, we don't have a problem with you," and then suddenly came out against us. But basically, their argument is, we don't have a problem with you. It's that if we allow you in without letting Pakistan in, that slams the door for Pakistan. And on almost every front where India and China have gotten into squabbles on the multilateral level, China's response has been, you know, the Pakistanis will be really unhappy. And this has now become a constant theme at this level of the relationship. And then finally, India was very nervous, or very unnerved, should we say, at the collapse of ASEAN. That in the South China Sea, ASEAN's incredibly weak resistance, in fact, zero resistance, to China's moves was really caught the Indian system by surprise. I mean, ASEAN had always been seen as the core of Asian regional architecture, defense cooperation. And that not only the lack of U.S. support for at least about the first 2.5 years of this dispute, but the fact that ASEAN was almost completely incapable of responding to Chinese pressure. And that, you know, three or four Southeast Asian countries immediately succumbed and basically said, we're with Beijing, forget about everything else. If we don't care about this, quote, Southeast Asian unity business. And then when India's own strongest allies in Southeast Asia, notably Singapore, for example, countries that were very clear. They said ASEAN is a disaster now. It's not, I remember the Singaporeans gave us a briefing saying that this is now it's a hollow shell as an organization. It doesn't really matter anymore. So for them, this is a sign in fact, there was actually somebody in very senior people in the government actually told me, they said, we can almost see the economic corridor being in many ways a version of what China is doing in terms of land reclamation in the South China Sea, using concrete and cement to change the very nature of the legitimacy of your political control over disputed territory. And for example, if they build the economic corridor, we will actually see Pakistan's claim on Kashmir to be only strengthened, and in a manner that means that China would effectively have to support Pakistan on this. And remember, China has actually been very careful to stay out of the Kashmir dispute historically. They've always said, Pakistan may be our all-weather friend, but this is a bilateral dispute between two countries that we're not involved in. So for them, the South China Sea was a metaphor for something that was happening on the other side, on the China-Pakistan economic corridor. So they still tried. There was still an attempt, again, to continue to try to develop a consultative process with China. As I've mentioned, attempts to talk about the One Belt, One Road, attempts to talk about maritime policy. China did eventually concede a maritime dialogue. We've now actually just been able to hold one. It wasn't very successful, but at least that dialogue process has begun. One Belt, One Road, zero interest by China in talking with us. But I've said this has been more than less counted by the fact that China has been very, very focused on basically saying that Pakistan, and that the Chinese argument, at least when I've talked to their analysts and academics and in the Track 2 dialogues which I'm part of, Pakistan, Chinese have basically said that, look, you have to understand, it's not just that Pakistan is a close friend. It's also the fact that Pakistan is a highly unstable country. And in our view, as America's withdrawal from Afghanistan means that American aid and arms to Pakistan slowly decline, for us, because of what we're facing in Xinjiang, Pakistan must somehow be stabilized. And the only way we can see how to do that is effectively to dump huge amounts of money in it, and in a manner China is very good at, which is large infrastructure projects, hence the CPEC. It also happens to gel, of course, with Xi Jinping's desire to externalize demand for infrastructure development in terms of cement, and 50% of the economic corridor is just power generation equipment. And so companies like Shanghai Electric and Dongfeng, which desperately need places to sell their equipment, this corridor would be a big boon. So I said India has been trying to reach out to China, still had virtually no real impact at all. And the sense now in India, when I talk to our diplomats, that the initial hope that 2014, which was Xi coming to power, would mean that we would be able to, in fact, a lot of them used to say that Hu Jintao and Manmohan Singh are very similar in many ways, both of them politically very weak and unable to push through policy. Xi and Modi are much more on the same sort of plane. We assume, therefore, given that Xi's own interest in economic external markets, that we would be able to develop that sort of relationship with him. That's more or less dead, that we've given up by about 2015, I'd say about by the summer of 2015, the sense in the government was that no, Xi doesn't really have any larger idea of how to handle this. And in fact, if anything, he's become extraordinarily obsessed with both the One Belt, One Road, the economic corridor of Pakistan, and therefore with Pakistan itself. So India's response overall has been, I think that I'm going to list four key elements of their Indian Ocean response to China. One is island diplomacy. Modi has visited now Mauritius, Seychelles, and Sri Lanka. And the only reason he hasn't visited the Maldives is because the present president of the Maldives is seen as a stooge of Saudi Arabia. It's the case of Seychelles, for example. It's an island that we haven't had an Indian prime minister go for almost over 20 years. And in each of them, though, he's driven a hard bargain. He says, we can give you enormous economic access, investment, largely through the Indian private sector. But in return, you have to come to a much closer military relationship with us. And what's been surprising, I think, for the Indian side is a lot of the island nations have been completely agreeable. I mean, Seychelles basically said, look, we've been waiting 20 years for you to show up with this offer because we've been signaling for a long time that we're interested and you basically would turn your back to us. So in Seychelles has given us Assumption Island, which dominates the northern entrance to Mozambique Channel. So just do build whatever you want on it. Doesn't matter to us. Mauritius allows us to now develop the Agalas Islands. Plus, we now effectively, in my view, control the Mauritian Navy is now basically a subset of the Indian Navy. Indian Navy officers would presumably be very happy to be deployed in Mauritius, a very nice place. Sri Lanka, we have now very close to, I think, interoperability with their Navy. It's a very good military relationship, even though the political relationship is on and off. And even Mozambique has given us a listening, Madagascar has given us a listening post, even though we haven't yet visited the island yet. And I'll just add that besides the island side, there's a littoral diplomacy side, which is very focused on Africa. As I said, ASEAN is shambles right now, but Modi has now visited. We had an Indo-Africa summit last year, and what was surprising, I think, again for the Indian side, was that we invited 54 out of the 55 African states. You have a choice of Morocco and Western Sahara. You can't get both. So we opted for Morocco and therefore lost Western Sahara. Every single one of them sent a delegation. It was the biggest, the second biggest multilateral summit India has ever hosted. And given that the limit, previously we'd never gotten more than about 20 African leaders, African delegations, the Indian system was actually quite horrified that these, in some cases, there was no government in that country, but they still somehow dug up somebody and sent it. Guinea-Bissau, Central African Republic surprised us. Libya's president was actually being held hostage by some militia group. And he still got one of his ministers to show up. But there was really, we actually ran out of hotel rooms. It was an enormous problem, especially when the King of Morocco showed up with a delegation of 450 people. he took one entire hotel, two hotels by himself. So the net result, though, is that we realized that particularly what was different now with Africa was a lot of them wanted security. They said, we want a military relationship with you. We've had the economic, we have the trade, we have the diaspora, we have all that. but what we really want is a military relationship. So we signed in that summit alone, if I remember correctly, 14 military relationships with 14 different African countries. A lot more wanted than we just didn't have the time or effort, ability to actually put them together. And Modi made his first major African tour. He visited four African states, Kenya, Tanzania, Mozambique, and South Africa, all of which were Indian Ocean littoral states, and all of which we deepened the military side of that relationship, besides the obvious normal trade economics and so on. And within that one country, and I'm going to stress this country because I think it's often missed, is Mozambique. Mozambique is now India's huge, in my view, it's the closest thing to an experiment by the Indian system to see if they can actually develop a incredibly strong, almost an alliance with an African state. We've been training the Mozambican Navy for a very long time, but we have now agreed to train their intelligence services, train their army. 25% of India's entire FDI into Africa, most of it's private sector, is now in one country, Mozambique, which is about, I think there'll be about $4 billion. And the Indian government has committed our state-owned oil and gas companies to invest $6 billion more into this one country, making Mozambique one of the largest recipients of Indian FDI in the world. And on almost every front, we are now dealing with on farming, healthcare, education, internet services. India is now expanding dramatically, whatever they can in Mozambique. Not easy, it's not the most stable of nations, but it's a country that we're now effectively saying, okay, this is going to be the equivalent of like a giant aircraft carrier southwestern Indian Ocean. And again, what is interesting for us is that the Mozambicans have been more or less very recipient to this idea. They have been across the board supportive of engaging with India on almost every front. And almost a lot of these proposals are coming from them. Train our intelligence services, fine, it's good. And so India is now basically experimenting. Can we as a nation, because we've never done it before, being able to develop this enormously multi-sectoral, multi-level relationship with one large African state on the Indian Ocean? The other second part of this Indian Ocean strategy is the multilateral side. So India is trying very hard to resurrect the IORA, the Indian Ocean Regional Association, which has been largely defunct. And as you know, Indonesia, India, and Australia have been the successive chairs of the IORA. And we're trying to see whether this can be developed into a genuine Indian Ocean agreement. BIMSTEC, the Bay of Bengal organization, which now incorporates countries that have nothing to do with the Bay of Bengal, like Nepal, is also now being resurrected as a much larger and more powerful institution, replacing in many ways the original SARC organization, which never got anywhere because of India and Pakistan disputes. The Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, the Blue Economy Plans, which still remain largely on paper, and MOSUM. MOSUM is just the Sanskrit Hindi word for monsoon. The word monsoon is a corruption of it. But basically, that's an attempt to use India's cultural influence in a lot of these in the Indian Ocean area to massively increase our soft diplomatic influence in these countries. A simple example is, for example, with Sri Lanka, when we would have problems with the government, one of the things we'd ask them, is there any way we can build up public support? And they said, well, we're a Buddhist nation, and sure, you're the home of the Buddha, where can you think of something? So we found, if you've been to Sri Lanka, you'll know that the Temple of the Tooth, which has supposedly the tooth of the Buddha, but since it's a tooth about this big, Buddha was a very big person, is the most sacred site in Sri Lanka. Well, the Indian government dug around and they found, actually, we have large chunks of the Buddha's skeleton lying all over India. Among other things, he has about 50 ribs and about 900 teeth. And he must have been bald by the time he died because he plucked a lot of hair out. So we just assembled large chunks of his skeleton and sent them to Sri Lanka and said, okay, for the first time, I think over 100 years, because I think the British did one small tour, but otherwise this is the first time we ever sent the remnants of the Buddha overseas. Definitely independent India has never done it. And it was, needless to say, an enormous success. My friends in Sri Lanka said the problem was really the huge battle that broke out among the Sri Lankan elite as to who was going to greet the aircraft when this enormous amount of holy relics showed up. And it was they did a tour of the country in which the president and prime minister actually led it on foot, barefoot in front of almost everywhere that it went. And an estimated 30% of the Buddhist population showed up to show. Now Myanmar is yelling at us, "Where the hell is why not here?" Because their greatest Buddhist temple is just six hairs of the Buddha, and again, compared to the amount of forensic material we have on him, it's quite small. So all of this we're now slowly putting together. Can we use this in ways that we have never bothered to do so before, to build up that network of influence in the Indian Ocean that India really hadn't done it? And remember, going back to the South China Sea, the Indian side looked at the South China Sea and said it was the amazing ease with which China was able to just take over this sea and basically overrun littoral influence in that area. Can we, if in effect, build up some sort of Indian influence that could resist that sometime 10, 20, 30 years down the line? It's an ocean, it's not even a sea, so it's much, much more difficult. But again, if we can get all of these things together, it'll make it much more difficult for China to be able, or any other country, to play that kind of a role. The third part of this is the defense relationship with two specific countries. I've mentioned in my previous video, US and Japan. Using the U.S. to slowly build up a military capacity and fill in the vacuums that the U.S. Is leaving behind. And again, the partner that's most active in this is the U.S. itself. Very, very eager to come in. So Ash Carter's come met our defense minister 8 times, and I said he's trying to come in one more time. And the Indian side is now accepted, if you wish. And the foreign secretary told us, we have depended on the U.S. to carry the burden of security in Asia. The limitations of the U.S. are now apparent. So we accept that this is now going to be the new norm, that we should understand that America will not play this game anymore or limited amounts. But America is very happy to allow us to move into that space and do whatever they can to help us. Japan is the other country I've mentioned. Again, it's part of bringing them into a larger balance of payments, balance of power issue in India, but also solving our balance of payments problem with their exports. And again, there for us, a game is, can we make Japan, we fully supporting Abe's attempts to normalize Japan and make it a normal military state, which is one reason the Indian system is so irritated when you guys didn't buy Japanese submarines, because we see buying Japanese arms as part of that strategy, and we're now negotiating to buy the US 2 seaplanes. But to be fair, Japan is a very difficult country to buy from. And then finally, the connectivity, the last element of that policy. It was mentioned by Rory that India talks about having many belts and many roads. That's true, but the real game for India is not to try to match China in infrastructure, which we have no capacity to do. But can we build a connectivity with India and the immediate neighbors? It goes back to that neighborhood policy. So Bangladesh, Myanmar, the Indian Northeast, has been now the focus of almost all of the projects we're trying to build with our aid program, to build a power grid, road, transit. And our diplomacy has been focused on getting Bangladesh to agree to this, because Bangladesh has been very hostile. So the land border agreement was signed under Modi, and the next step is the Teesta water agreement. Once those are done, Bangladesh basically will start to open up, has already begun opening up a lot of this to us. And one of the reasons why this is a little more credible than most other Indian such plans is it's being financed by Japan. Japan has come in and said, we want to be partners to this, and we're prepared to pay for all of it. So don't worry, the money is not an issue. You need to do the diplomacy side, and you need to start getting all of the planning and getting the local population. We're bad at that. We'll finance. And the Bay of Bengal, which is why BIMSTEC is important, is a further extension of building the so-called Sagar Mela projects, building the ports, coastal infrastructure in the Bay of Bengal, which India has actually done a terrible job of. We focused almost everything on the western side, and now we can do that. And I'll just give a final quote by the foreign secretary in his Rice in a Hill speech a couple of years ago. Quote, connectivity today has become a yardstick to measure influence, and has emerged as a theater of present-day geopolitics. And it goes back to this whole idea that you can change geopolitical reality now by building infrastructure. It's a very clear lesson we've learned from China, and we now need to respond, at least to some degree, in doing exactly the same thing. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Kermit. And I'd like to come back a little bit later to test you on where you think things are likely to go in terms of the India-China relationship in Pakistan and CPEC. What does the future hold for that? But in the meantime, if I could ask Professor Jingdong Yuan from University of Sydney to respond to some of Pramit's comments.
All right. Thanks very much. Let me thank the National Security College and also Australia-India Institute for the invitation for this very interesting conference. Now, I've been doing China-Indian relations for over 15 years. Right? Over these, not solely on China-India, I'm doing other matters as well. But one of the experiences I've got is if I go to China, I talk to Chinese analysts about China-Indian relations, and they say, oh, this is all Indians' fault. You know, we're trying to do this and that. But you talk Indian analysts, it was all Chinese fault, right? So after 15 years, I still don't know, you know, whose fault. I mean, certainly one cannot, what do you call the tango, right? So it must be both of them bear both, responsibilities and, for some of the faults. And then they are also can cooperate and to generate opportunities. So what I'm going to do is that basically, I'm going to focus on sort of four key points. The first one I already, in my intervention earlier, is about China's Indian Ocean strategy, very much informed by China's dependence on energy. Well, so Indian Ocean is becoming very, very critical. It's not what China, desired to do, it's what China has to do. Right? It's because energy supply, raw materials, trade lines, and ceilings of communication are very, very important for China, especially when you hear about the talks by other great powers, and certainly in the think tanks world, about how you can actually strangle China, in a protracted conflict to set up a blockade. That worries China. Right? So that is very, important reason for China. So in 2004, President Hu Jintao actually told the PLA, the People's Liberation Army, is basically you have a new historical mission, right? So that mission is to follow China's interest. You can no longer just be confined to brown water or even green water. You have to look beyond to developing a sort of blue navy, right? Blue water navy, because China's slots and all these important interests. Now, about 12 years later, it's not only about resources, all the energy supplies, trade. It is also about expanding Chinese business interests all over the world. Today, about 5 million Chinese working all over the world. I mean, in Africa alone, 2 million. Chinese working, right? So you have to protect Chinese lives, Chinese asset, right? So the mission is only going to grow over time. So that's the sort of the larger picture. The second point I want to make is if you look at the China-India competition or perception or misperception, or maybe possible cooperation with regard to Indian Ocean, you have to put this into the broader domestic and international context. Right? I agree with Pramit that both Hu Jintao and Maritime Singh are more of a moderate, low-key leaders. Right? So they're not that appear to be assertive, strong and active. But they still care very much about the domestic agendas and priorities. That is economic development. Right? So that's the key. So if you look at during their overlapping, of course, not exactly matching Hu and then Singh, but they overlap quite a bit, is the economic ties and trade between these two countries had grown significantly. Right? But now, of course, the trade has reached to a plateau. I mean, over the last few years, stagnate. That has a number of other reasons to explain. And also, in the first decade, I mean, certainly 2000, 2008, or certainly maybe 2004, 2014, during Singh's tenure, there's a lot going on between India and the United States. The nuclear deal and certainly the next step in defense cooperation, space, and everything else. Now, China initially was quite worried in the early phase of U.S.-Indian cooperation, but eventually, if you look at China during the Bush administration, actually after 9/11, there was a lot of cooperation. You know, global war on anti-terrorism. They both tried to stabilize cross-strait relations and try to manage the North Korean nuclear issue. So there's a lot of cooperation going on. Now moving forward to 2012, Xi Jinping came into power, and then 2014, Modi came into power. I mean, initially, I think, again, I mean, the broader international environment for China has certainly changed because the global financial crisis, now China emerged as the second largest economy. And then Chinese leadership and China as a whole became a more sort of confident, and the foreign policy became a more sort of assertive, more sort of firm, and so forth. But if you look at Chinese leaderships, at least from what they do as a signal of what their foreign policy or diplomacy priority is, Premier Li Keqiang, when he became the premier in 2013, first, he picked India as one of his first countries to visit. And 2014, Xi Jinping went to India, and Modi came to China in 2015. So in 3 years, you have top leaders, exchange a visit. If you go back like one or two decades, it's almost a decade you will have one top leader visit, right? So last time Chinese President Jiang Zemin visited India was 1996. 10 years later, Hu Jintao went to India, so 10 years. But this time around is much shorter. So both, certainly the Chinese top leader express or demonstrate that sort of willingness to engage China. So sometimes I find it very sort of puzzling if China often ignores India, and I often ask the Chinese analysts, why do you give the impression that you ignore India, right? India is a rising power now. Today, India has a very shiny growth rate, record 7.5. And if look at the demographic trend, everything in India will be moving up very rapidly up the ladder there. So that's one of the issues or the question I often want to, to ask, want to get the answer to. But both Xi Jinping and Modi are very active, bold, and a very strong leader. But again, if you look at their domestic agenda, still very strong domestic priorities. For Xi Jinping, is a China dream, the 2-100. So it's a very much economically driven, agenda. Even One Belt, One Road is more of to extend, how to release the pressure or the overcapacity, and then to just build up infrastructure, make all these connections, Belt and Road, and to extend China's economic connections, and then to basically to recover some of the lost market, as a result of the GFC of 2008. Modi as well, making India, right? So it's a very strong desire to turn India to pay more attention in manufacturing. It was not just office floor. I remember 2002, when Chinese Premier Zhu Rongji visited India, he basically said, well, here's, if the India serves the office and then China's the world factory, and then if we cooperate, we pretty much, you know, own everything in the world. You know, it's a very good match there. But these two strong leaders, of course, and both growing sort of confidence, pride, nationalism, also informed the leaders to pursuing very strong foreign policy. Right? But I think, of course, both are strong, but they are both very pragmatic. Again, to respond to the you know, some Chinese negligence of India, or, you know, why China was not engaging India. If you look at China's priorities or preoccupation or China's problems over the last 4 years, it's all the way in the east. So South China Sea, Japan, United States pivot. So a lot of effort and energy are actually toward the east. So it would be quite amazing, quite fallacious for China to, again, to sort of deliberately cause the relationship with India to go sour. You know, why would you do that, right? So you want to, you know, stabilize in the Indian Ocean. So that's the sort of the second largest, sort of the broader context, right? Thirdly, I think is, given what we heard and given the a lot of the problems between India and China, I can identify some of those may come or because of this lack of strategic trust. Right? Of course, history bears some responsibility, the war in the past. Pakistan is a major factor there. Right? And China, the fact that China becomes more and more stronger, and then the Chinese assertive foreign policy in South China Sea certainly sends a strong signal to India there. So all of these creates a level of suspicion and concerns in India. Right? So you have this So in my years of research, I often tell my students, there are five words that pretty much summarize Sino-Indian relations, right? Five T's, you know, the English letter T, right? Territorial dispute, Tibet, threat perception, triangles, you know, China, India, Pakistan, and increasingly now China, US, and India, you know, triangles, and trade. Even this is a positive aspect because there are a lot of trade deficit, so that also creates becomes a problem. Now today I will add another I. It's the Indian Ocean, so it's the P, you know, T's and I. Right? So these pretty much summarize China-Indian relation, and they lead to a number of M's. Right? So it's misunderstanding, misapprehension that may lead to miscalculation, right? And sort of. Miscommunication. So all of the AMs. So it's basically further, caused the problem to even more severe. Now, one of the questions I want to ask is, of course, we have multiple, increasingly more, not just two government. There are multiple players. Right? So you have foreign ministry types. You have the military types. Right? You have think tanks. And then you have media, right? So how do they, you know, what are the stakes for them, and how do they perceive the problems and the opportunity, and then how do they engage in the discussion, you know, internal discussion or public discourse, you know, like media? So I find very little sort of, certainly I would like to see more positive, you know, coverage in the media. And in that regard, sometimes, of course, Global Times projects very negative image there. Now, related to the mistrust or lack of trust is some of the incidents that cited by you, David, you know, prior to President Xi's visit, and some other incident, not only in China-India, but also U.S.-China. You know, many times, you know, important leader like Defense Secretary Bob Gates visit before he was to meet President Hu, and China test fly this J-20 or stealth fighter. So why would those kind of things occur? You know, if you think about it, here's the important summit meeting. Why would you have those kind of incidents to cast a shadow? I mean, the only two explanations you can give is one is deliberate, you know, to send a message. This is what I can do, right? And can get away with. But that's it's kind of hard to believe increasingly as China becomes a stronger and stronger power and needs to have more soft power, you know, a better smart diplomacy. The second would be some, what I argue, party-state relations or the party-military relations. So sometimes the control, civilian control of the military may not be that tight. Now, finally, I would close after all these very pessimistic description is China-Indian relations today is very much institutionalized. Right? You have top leader meetings, you have all sorts of channels of interactions. And both China and India are also in a lot of multilateral institutions. Right? They form in different sort of memberships, BRICS and G20 and all of that. So there are ways to, you know, coordinate and talk and engage in dialogue. So all these, sort of the negatives could be managed if not completely removed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, JD. Giving us, I suppose, a little bit more of an optimistic view, I suppose, or at least a view around miscommunication or misapprehensions, as you put it. Just before we take a few questions, if I could just get 2 minutes answer from Premit. Baluchistan, CPEC, how's that going to play out?
Well, as I said earlier, the Indians have realized or come to the view that this has now become a major, I should say, obsession with Xi Jinping in particular, that he has to get this to succeed. And the Chinese, on the other hand, at least what I'm reading and hearing, are increasingly nervous because the more they look at places like Baluchistan, they wonder how are they going to handle the security in that area. They've also been, in my view, sold the plot by the Pakistanis, which is that, oh, all of the problems in Baluchistan are being handled by India, or India's behind it all. So we've had a very bizarre situation where China coming to us, to the Indian side, and saying, you have to endorse the economic corridor. And India said, absolutely not. It goes to Kashmir. How can we endorse something that we claim is our own? And the Chinese said, well, you know what that means. That means you're going to cause lots of problems. And the Indian side, Modi has said publicly, in fact, at Tsinghua University, gave a speech. He said, you go ahead and build your One Belt, One Road. We're not going to, how can we stop it? And we may actually support bits and pieces of it. We can use those same ports like everybody else. But don't expect us to endorse something that will automatically Pakistan will use to then use in their disputes against us. This has now become, ironically, one of the biggest problems between India and China, because the Chinese now have come to the conclusion this means that the security costs for the corridor are going to rise. So India, as I said, now flipped it and said, okay, well, if that's what you believe, then we'll use it against you. You giving us problems on NSG or various other places, well, then we're going to sit down and actually make a noise about Baluchistan, which we didn't before. And this is effectively now being used by India to pressure China into pressuring Pakistan on various issues. And when I talked to the Pakistani military officers, they said that actually the biggest reason that we're reluctant to give you more trouble on the line of control in other areas is because Beijing starts to flip out. See, what is wrong with you? You get into a crisis with India, then how can we build a corridor? And the security, there was an article, I think, in Xinhua agency, which said that the Chinese are now getting nervous because the security cost of the economic corridor, the bill keeps rising. Now, in my view, Baluchistan, if anybody knows Baluchistan, it's almost as crazy as Afghanistan. So I met a former military advisor to the governor of Balochistan once, a lieutenant colonel in the Pakistani army. And I asked him, so you were in a relatively quiet period. He said, yes, I was. And I said, so how many problems were you facing? He said, I had 14 separate insurgencies I was fighting in Balochistan at that point. And that was considered a pretty low-key period. It was peaceful. At any given time, about half the population is rebelling and killing each other. And any foreigner is just taken away and kidnapped and held for ransom. And, you know, noses and ears are sent back to people for payment purposes. So I don't see whatever China does, they're going to face an enormous security problem. But India is just exploiting it right now, playing on these Chinese fears and trying to extract various little things out of China.
Thank you. That's an optimistic scenario.
For us, it's not. China's going to build in Balochistan, right. Let them go ahead and
start. Okay. Questions?
Pakistan's nuclear weapons, and what sort of reaction do you think China, or what sort of assistance might China be able to give in this sensitive area?
I haven't heard anything of the Chinese specifically on nuclear safety. What they are definitely concerned about is just the broader stability of Pakistan. In our closed-door sessions with the Chinese, they have been very clear that they see a direct link with the instability of the AFPAC area and what they're experiencing in Xinjiang. When I've talked to the American State Department, like the U.S. Embassy in Beijing, it has a very good counterterrorism group, which I meet every now and then when I go to Beijing, they've been very clear that they said the number of incidents with Muslim problems in China has been rising quite rapidly, including incidents that are not reported. And they said the Chinese are now nervous because it's no longer just the Uyghurs. It's now spreading into at least three other Muslim groups, many of which are by Han descent and therefore very difficult for them to track. I think the Way is the other group that is now becoming radicalized quite rapidly, Muslim population. And the Chinese simply, and in fact, I think Chinese in my view are aggravating it by forcing them to eat pork and doing other strange things, which I don't see how that helps, but anyway. So the Chinese now have this big fear that if Pakistan starts to go down a tube, then what happens to them in Xinjiang, let alone their credibility, since this is theoretically their all-weather friend, will be basically go for a toss. Nuclear safety, as I said, the Chinese don't, at least they've never talked to me about it, but my sense is that they just see this as part of just a subset of this larger issue. And for them, the heart of it is that, and this is where I think India and China would disagree on this, India's basic argument is that the problem in Pakistan is the Pakistan military. And that as long as Pakistan is not allowed to become a normal functioning democracy, you will perpetually have a military that will support and allow the various versions of Islamic militancy to play because they will need it against either because they need it against India or because they need it in their other games in Afghanistan. The Indian system has been, none of the democratic leaders of Pakistan are a problem as far as India is concerned. In fact, we have very good relationships. Modi has a great relationship with Nawaz Sharif, for example. They find that they get along perfectly well. For them, it's a Pakistan military. The Chinese response is basically, no, Pakistan is simply so unstable, it's very similar to the old American line, that we have to deal with the only stable institution left is the military. So we have to keep them holding them up. And the Indian side is, well, that's because they undermine all of the other institutions and make themselves the issue. On the Indian nuclear safety issue, India's concern about Pakistan's nuclear safety is that, well, it's aimed at us, so we don't expect us to do very well. But the definition of what is a safe Pakistani can almost be defined by who Pakistan puts to guard their nuclear safety establishments. The Indian intelligence, as I remember, showed me once, they said, look, when they began, the Pakistanis began to get nervous about the loyalty of Baluchis or Pashtuns, they took all of their guards who were of those ethnic origins away from the nuclear installations. Then they got scared about the Shia because they were repressing them so hard, so they took all the Shia out. Then they got nervous about the Sindhis and they took them out. Now, it's effectively, you have to be a northern Pakistani landowning class, a Chaudhary if you wish, and of Sunni origin and from an army family from northern Punjab, not even southern Punjab anymore, to be allowed to guard the nuclear safety establishment. So that it's now shrinking. I mean, they now reduce themselves to about 20% of their population. And it continues on this date. They won't have anybody left except like 10 people in their army that they allow them to run the nuclear installations.
Hello, I'm Jared Oakes. I'm with Foreign Affairs and Trade. Pramit, I just wanted to ask you, you spoke about Indian outreach to countries like Mauritius and Madagascar and Seychelles. Wedged in between them, of course, is the French in Reunion, and they're a significant naval power. So I just wondered how the Indians and the French get on and whether they've been brought into this conversation about China at all.
We get along. We buy a lot of our weapons from them. We just, as you know, we just bought the Rafale, 36 Rafale aircraft, which will effectively be our airborne nuclear deterrent and replace the aging Mirages that we'll be phasing out. And like you, we bought Scorpion submarines that we bought them about 15 years ago. And so we have always seen France as the interim solution to buying Russian or buying American. And when our relationship with America was not so good, we didn't diversify away from Soviet stuff. We used to buy French, and we do work closely with their Indian Ocean, on the military side. We're very close to them, especially in places like Seychelles, which is effectively an Anglo. They've tried to help us in Madagascar, but Madagascar, the Malagasy government is highly unstable. And even they've struggled, but they've been very clear that wherever we've gone in Africa, the French have been very happy to open doors for us, as to be fair, Portuguese and other European countries. But it's a limit. The French don't really have that much capacity anymore, and particularly in the past 5 years, their defense budget has been slashed, and their presence in the Indian Ocean is increasingly residual. And wherever we can, we've basically moved into places like Seychelles and Mauritius, definitely. We've now taken over a lot of the French space in that area, which is France is happy to hand over because they just don't have, it just costs them too much to hold out. So we cooperate very well with the French. But my instinct is that as the relationship with America is now taking off, and I think we're buying more and more American equipment, our French game will effectively now start to die off. There are clusters of European purchases. We'll probably buy the Saab Gripen. It'll probably emerge as our basic donkey work fighter over the next 20 years, partly because we'll buy the entire company. I mean, we'll just transfer the entire assembly line and we'll move to India. But France is important to us, but France's own strategic picture in Asia, it's the last European country that really has one, is now shrinking.
Maybe if we could take two questions.
Thank you, Michael, from the National Security College. You spoke extensively about Mozambique and a number of island nations which India is looking to strengthen its relationship with. Is India looking at all to strengthen its relationship with Indonesia on the other side of the Indian Ocean and a country which controls areas of the Malacca Straits, which are obviously important in India's sort of movement into the Pacific Ocean or even the South China Sea region? Thank you.
Paul Myler from DFAT, one for Pramit, for both. We mentioned Ash Carter a couple of times and his enthusiasm. I think in the last press conference they did with Parakeer, he actually said he wanted the US-India relationship to be the defining relationship of this century, which seemed like an extraordinary thing to say. I'd be interested in your thoughts on the magnitude of that.
Yes, Indonesia... Indonesia, I suppose we may have had the same problem. We found it very difficult to keep them interested. Suharto was simply not interested in maritime, naval, anything. And he saw, he drove in many ways, Indonesia was at the heart of ASEAN's success in those days in conjunction with Singapore. So we struggled with him, and I think we more or less gave up. And there was a surge, I think, in about the mid-2000s, Obijit, you may remember, where Indonesia was actually our number one naval exercise partner in the world. And there was a huge number of them. Indonesian military, we find, is actually quite okay with working with us and very interested. But Indonesia's civilian governments are switch on and off. And we've really struggled to maintain any steady relationship with Indonesia. It's never hostile. I mean, it was hostile if you go back to Sukarno. But it's never been hostile, but they just really don't. Strategic thinking that incorporates the Indian Ocean and China for Indonesia. The military are very Sinophobic, but the civilian leadership really find it hard to focus on this.
Jokowi at least has now publicly called for a return to a maritime policy. But again, we've still so far not been able to get any real traction from him. And I've had frustrated Indian diplomats say to me, say, it's still like he's the mayor of Jakarta. He still hasn't thought beyond this. One day he'll think about Sumatra, and then we'll be on a step to start thinking about India. But we really struggle. So Singapore, in comparison, which is a country we've really had a long and steady relationship with, you know, has been our primary interlocutor for Southeast Asia for a long while. Indonesia, we don't have a problem, but it's been difficult. Malaysia has genuinely been hostile, full stop, so we've really all given up on working with them. Carter Gates, you know, Bob Gates said the same thing. Bob Gates, when he left, he told Carter, if I remember, I think Ash told me this. He said, you know, Ash, it's only India is the only real story that we have to finish. And it goes back, I think, to, again, I'm going to go back to when the Bush administration was negotiating a nuclear deal. I remember I was in Washington for 18 months, and I remember working everybody from Joe Biden to Hillary Clinton. I'd meet them, all of these people. And they all said the same thing. They said, you know, that Bush, one of the reasons there was such a bipartisan consensus in supporting the Indo-US nuclear deal was, one, that there was no hostility to India. Nobody disliked India. Everybody thought, you can push on almost everybody. Nobody really dislikes you. The non-proliferationists didn't like the fact that the nuclear deal was, that the relationship was being built on a nuclear issue. But otherwise, they didn't have a problem with the relationship. But they really fundamentally saw that they had an opportunity to bring India into a larger Western-oriented security architecture and a relationship that they felt was absolutely essential for. And it, as I said, it was bipartisan. I never met anybody in the American system who didn't disagree with this basic argument. And that, in many ways, I remember Clinton's, the Democratic Party, said that the guy who began this, they would argue, I remember Richard Holbrooke said, the man who began this was John F. Kennedy. He was the closest to your country till Bush arrived. And the only reason it didn't work was because he was assassinated, and then we got sucked into Vietnam. But it's always been in the back of America's minds. And Henry Kissinger and I once discussed this, and he said, fundamentally, nobody in the American system can believe a democracy will ever be an enemy of our country. He says, textbook international relations would argue differently, but he says, there is simply nobody who does not believe that you should be on our side. So when you come eventually knocking and saying we're interested, the whole system gets excited because this is the opportunity we had. Ash Carter has been part of, I've been part of the Aspen Institutes of India and America dialogue for 10 years now. It's been head by Joe Nye, Nick Burns, Kissinger, and Carter's been with it for 10 years, and Kurt Campbell is another one who yells loudly at the top of his voice to every Indian audience he meets, don't you understand that we are destined to be strategic allies? And he does this everywhere he goes in India. He just yells and shouts and says the same thing. But I said it's bipartisan. I can't find anybody who doesn't believe this to be the case in America.
Yes, I agree with everything you said. In a purely bilateral context. But it's important to know what is this relationship for. I mean, it's two democracies consolidating their relationship. They share same values. They have similar security concerns. That's all fine. But once you move the next step, I think there are quite a bit of sort of expectations, but misplaced expectations. So for instance, the United States and Japan, for that matter, in 2006 and 2007, they wanted to develop a sort of the arch of democracy. So once China or some other third party becomes the target, and then I think at least, as I understand India, it's a very strong emphasis on foreign policy independence, probably will see how that will serve Indians' interest, rather than how that will serve US-India relationship. So I think that's the critical difference there. So I'm beginning to worry about a lot of those talks about security partnership in Asia Pacific, Australia, Japan, India, and all. So they all seem to have this sort of a great expectations of where security buddies. So if China does something to you and to you and to you, and then we expect you and you will come to our existence, that is not the case.
Yeah, let me just add to that.
Yeah, it's still national interest rather than, I mean, these are...
There's no question of an alliance. In fact, I don't think Americans are interested in an alliance. And everybody forgets that in 1962, at the height of the Sino-Indian War, we asked for an alliance with America, and they refused. John Kenneth Galbraith, in his memoirs, he says, the American Indians have asked for a full-flown military alliance. I have recommended to Kennedy to say no. It is not in America's interest to get into an alliance with a country this large. Those days are over. By 1962, the Americans already concluded. And I'm not too sure they've actually signed any major treaty, many major military alliance since 1960s. I mean, the Eisenhower period was the peak, and after that, they basically said, we don't want to get involved. They find that the other country tends to use America for other purposes that have nothing to do with America's interest. I would argue that the sophisticated American strategic view, and this is the Kissingers and so on, William Perry's and Bob Gates, the argument is that we have to build up India as a nation. I'll give an anecdote. I met Nick Burns when he was deputy secretary. I said, why are you supporting the nuclear deal? And he said, because you have made the fundamental decision or that you are going to be a democracy, whatever happens. 50 years from now, whether India succeeds or not, I can't predict. But you have made the fundamental decision that you will be a democracy for the next 50 years. China has no idea what its political system will be 50 years. The Chinese leadership doesn't even know. They accept that it's not going to work that well. We have to change. We don't know what will be. So for America, it's very clear. Your democracy, you're going to be safe. Now, the sophisticated American argument is basically, let India be India. Let it be independent, sovereignty conscious. I remember during the nuclear deal, a lot of Bush guys said, really, our only hope is that you'll be about as close to us as De Gaulle was in France. I mean, that's about as close. You'll be ornery, difficult to work with. But fundamentally, you're not going to be a threat to the United States. But what we do expect is that because you will also be ornery and independent, your relationship with China will be terrible. Right? I mean, all the countries that America has a problem with, you are going to just get into awful spats with them. And that's fine. That will provide the balance that we want. You don't have to be an alliance and an ally anymore. You just have to be yourself. And that's, but just be a very powerful version of that, and that's good enough for us.
Thank you very much, and I think we'll end it with that. And thank you very much, Pramit Pal Chowdhury and Professor Jingdong Guan.